Hello, everybody. If you're here already, we're starting a little bit early. I'm just getting everything set up right now so that we can go live with John Kaiser. If you're coming in later to watch this show, I have to part of the show I have to broadcast live the pre-show. Simply because I have to get everything live, such as what you just heard there, as part of the process of getting everything live for my website. So just be patient with me here for a couple minutes, and I'm going to get everything live, including getting John Kaiser on the show, our most important part of the show, which is the guest. I've just put it up on the website. So now, for those that, just a moment here, sorry about this. For those that are now watching the show live on the website, just bear with me for a second. I'm inviting John Kaiser on the show, and shouldn't take too long before he gets here. Bear with me. Got to get the right page for him to go to in order to get John on here live. If I could just find where the email is now, my life would be so much easier. There we go. Send that to John. Okay, so now I've got the website set up live. I've got me on live, and now I'm just awaiting John Kaiser to join us. Shouldn't be too long for John. Yes, I see everything is set up on the website. Everything else is set up. We're just awaiting John now. So yeah, I can chat here a little bit before John arrives. Again, this is the pre-show taping. I have to do it this way in order to get everything live on my website, my guest on live. So we call this the pre-show taping. Some guests, even John, like John Kaiser, get a good audience even in the pre-show. We're having a good audience for the live show as well, and that has a lot to do with the picks that John's been making on our shows lately. I got to write those down. John has made a series of really good picks for us. And on the show, unfortunately, have a little bit of toothpaste still left over. John's been making some excellent calls on the show. And giving us a heads up. And I'm really excited to have John on. We should be starting any minute now. I just have sent the message out to John. If you're arriving here to watch the recorded version, what I do is if you look above me on the website, I put in the little synopsis there, where into the show you have to look for the actual show to begin. Unfortunately, this is the way we have to do it. Google does a great job of with their coordination of a live broadcast. It's actually, they enable you to have a live broadcast in a box, sort of, for free. But you got to do some of this, a little bit of technology workarounds here to make everything look seamless. I do my best. I should have John on the show any second now. Actually, I'm going to give him a call just to make sure. Sometimes I send it to his wrong email. John has two emails that I can send it to. And unfortunately, I send it to the wrong one every once in a while. Where is John's phone number? He knows we're on at noon, so usually John's pretty good if he doesn't see my invite. Sorry, folks. I'm just coordinating the show here. This is the pre-show part. Sometimes we run into some technical difficulties. John, where are you? Just bear with me a few minutes here, folks. We'll get this baby working. Oh, I think this is his. I'm just giving John a call here, folks. Sorry about this. Might be his office number, I think.
It's Rob.
Oh, Rob, I called the wrong number. Sorry, man. I'm live here on a show. I'll call you back. That was not the correct guy. One of my buddies will be waiting for a phone call back. He has a similar number to John's. John, where are you? Creek. That's Kaiser. Just give John a call here.
Hello.
John.
Hey,
did I send the email to the wrong place, John?
Well, I keep clicking here, waiting for it to show up, and I've seen nothing from you.
Huh. I sent it to your...
Are you sending it to CanSpec Research?
Oh, damn. I think I sent it to your other one. Sorry, CanSpec...
Oh, I see. It just came in on the other one.
Oh, there you are. CanSpec Research. This is the correct one. Sorry. Okay, it's coming to you, John.
I'll move to the other computer where...
Sorry about that, John. I hung up on you by accident. There it is. I hope Mr. Google folks get this through to you real quick. Sorry about that, folks. We have some technical difficulties with Gmail, it appears. Gmail is the service that I use, and got to John a little slower than I had anticipated. Sorry about that, folks. We're running a little bit late here. John will be on any minute. As I said, John's been doing really good on the show recently. He's had a bunch of top picks. John was recently at the Prospectors Developers Conference back in March. He came out with a great report. So every time John's on the show, he gets lots of folks come on to watch. So I'm really excited about our guest here. The pre-show is much longer than it usually is. It looks like it's going to be about 7 or 8 minutes, folks. Sorry about that. This is why we do a pre-show. We get some of these technical glitches. For those that are watching at a later date, look above, and I'm going to have the time that the actual show starts. And I see John Kaiser coming in right now. It shouldn't take more than a couple more seconds for John to be live. John, I see you're live. Can you hear me okay?
You're a bit faint.
How's that? Is it your speaker?
I'm playing with my speakers. Okay, no, the other things.
Okay.
That's better.
I'm going to get started here, John. We're running a little late to get things going. That's okay. I'll fix it later. You ready?
Yep.
Okay, good. I'm going to get started here. I'm Alan Barry Labucan. I'm the founder of the Alan Barry Reports and your host for this show. Anyone who's been listening to me in the pre-show knows that I got a great guest today in John Kaiser. John's been on fire lately with his picks. He's been on fire on our show with picks. He was also recently at the PDAC conference, came up with his best, what he calls his best list ever. We talked extensively about it on one of the shows. John, thanks a lot for coming on today.
Oh, it's great to be back on with you, Alan.
I see you got scandium up there. I like that.
Got scandium.
We're going to have to talk about that too, John. I just reminded me. Good. Yes, definitely. So why don't I get started with the usual routine before we get into John's picks, some of the stuff we've talked about. I do my regular routine, which is to introduce my sponsors. My website sponsors are Wolfden Resources. They have a high-grade discovery out in Snow Lake, Manitoba. This is an extremely well-known area for high-grade nickel and copper, and they're really close to town. They've got a lot going for them, done a few drill programs. They're learning about the model. They're doing more drilling shortly, and I'm really excited about that sponsor. Another sponsor is Premier Gold. Premier Gold has a wide range of projects from exploration for gold right through to production. They have an enviable portfolio of projects as far as I'm concerned and are well positioned for growth long into the future. PG is their symbol. Wolfden's WLF. And my other company is West Red Lake Gold Mines. Their symbol's RLG on the Toronto Exchange. They have a 60-40 joint venture in favor of West Red Lake Gold with Goldcorp on a classic Red Lake Gold target called the Hinge Zone. They'll be drilling for that in their next program, which comes up after spring break. Their symbol's RLG. That's my sponsors. John, you following any of my sponsors closely?
I'm following Wolfden, which has been a little disappointing in getting out of its sort of 10-11 cent range. This seems to be the problem that the polymetallic exploration companies have not yet attracted the attention that the gold exploration companies. And of course, today gold is up $20, so everybody's more excited about them. But the Chinese, for whatever reason, have gone berserk trading commodities futures, and they've been a bit of a push behind a lot of these contracts in China, futures contracts going up. But we're also seeing the Baltic Dry Index has managed to, instead of it continuing downwards, has actually turned up in the past quarter, which is absolutely unrelated to Chinese speculation on futures contracts. That's suggesting that there might be a turnaround in the movement of dry goods, which includes raw materials. So I think projects such as Wolfden with its polymetallic play in Manitoba, it's just a matter of time before investors come around and say, what are you showing here? What's going on? And they get those kinds of 50 to 100% gains that we've seen in a lot of bottom fish.
Yeah, I think you're pretty right on that, John. I think also what's the situation with Wolfden is I picked it really early in the exploration cycle, and they came on as a sponsor really early. And that's an evolving sort of model of what they have there. And it's still early stages. That's a big, big target. And it's going to take some work to understand it. What I was excited about in the last batch of drilling is it looks like the pinching and swelling is along strike and at depth. And those are the kind of pockets that these, fluids could form, trap a bulk of fluids in there, pretty high grade fluids out there, John. So yeah, I'm really happy with Wolfden as a sponsor, and they're well funded and can keep that drill rig going. And I think any day we could hit one of those nice nickel copper cobalt drill holes that catch the imagination of the market.
Ewan probably doesn't want to hear this, but I think it's just fine that Wolfden sits here at 10, 11 cents because as I finish dealing with all these other bottom fish that have gone way up, I need to have some stills idling at the dock that we can jump into and get going as this market gains traction. By the way, I think since we last talked, I swapped the bear out for the bull, or for a bull on my charts that I have on my website. I think in the past 2 weeks we went through that inflection point where the risk that this New Year market rally is going to die, you know, via the PDAC curse. We survived that. I think we are now in a resource sector bull cycle that has a lot of running room. It doesn't need to go exponential. What's really interesting about it is, you know, gold moving from 1050 to 1250 is fine, but it's really not a big enough move to put a lot of these gold projects well into the money. And the sort of recovery we've seen in the base metals are also quite modest. So I think it's really interesting to have seen like the majors, the big producers, the mid-tiers, and even juniors double and sometimes triple in the last 3 months, despite fairly modest gains in the metal prices. So I think this is a great time to be looking at these kinds of juniors and exploration ones, which already have a system such as Wolfden. Well, if the market wants to let them idle there, that suits me fine, because as we finally get flushed up with cash from being able to sell the ones that maybe run too much, we got to have a place to put that. And having some laggards is a great thing to have around.
You know, John, one of the reasons our shows tend to be lengthy, and I'm not going to apologize for that, because we get great viewership and they watch for a long time. But it's because you always bring up important points during the conversation. You brought up two from what you just said that I want to talk about. One is, you mentioned an inflection point. And it's coincidental that you mentioned that, John, because I've been noticing a pattern in the stock, chart, that I was right on top of the January effect. I had noticed in the early part of the year that there was new buying coming into gold, and I had been looking for the shift from bull to, or bear to bull, for quite some time. So I kind of caught that January effect before it happened, and then it looked like it was going to create a cup type formation. Since that cup happened at the end of the bear market, the trend has been kind of going sideways. And lately, that sideways action has been, if you put a line across the tops and you put a line across the bottoms, it's been pointing to an inflection point at about $1,245 on gold. And I just thought I would mention that, because as you're saying, we're at an inflection point sort of on a fundamental basis. We're seeing a inflection point on the chart. And what you also said about the where the money's flowing into was the other point. It seems to be flowing into quality, which really excites me, John, because one, I think as we come out of that inflection point, we go higher for gold. And I hope that it's the money flows into the quality.
Yeah, I mean, we just need gold to continue to hold its gains inch higher. We don't need a charge to 2,000 or something like that. That's probably more destabilizing. But the sense that even when gold has its little bit of a setback, the price is short up. New buying comes in. It takes the gold. We don't have the kind of smackdowns that we had since 2013, when Goldman Sachs went to war against gold. In fact, their prediction of $1,000 gold is starting to look quite pitiful right now, and they must be scratching their head. How can we like turn this around and not be wrong?
Well, you know, if I was them, and what gives me lots of confidence, John, that as we go through this inflection point, that we will continue this is actually pretty rational type trading that's happening with gold coming out of a bear market. It's, you know, it formed the bottom happened, it started to go to the upside, had a little bit of a consolidation period now. But my big argument for this signal of where it's going to go post this inflection point is the US dollar trend. Look at that thing since the end of since February, John, and it has been trading like a penny dreadful after bad news. I think that that's the tell of where we're going after. And if you look at gold today popping up and the US dollar getting hammered, kind of, you know, lends to that argument.
Well, I think that has something to do with figures that suggest the economy has been growing less robustly than everybody hoped. And the implication is their willingness to raise the interest rates higher is going to be somewhat diminished, which means that there is more time for inflationary pressures to build up. So you see, the game Yellen has to play right now is how does she get some inflation back so that the economy starts growing properly again, but not have it go out of control? And the velocity of money is still terribly low, but that can turn around very quickly. And so that's a really subtle turning point. But by the way, when I refer to the inflection, I'm talking about investor psychology, not so much the statistics of the gold price. The point I'm making is if gold can hang around here, you know, plus or minus $50 and maybe trend higher, that's what this market needs. This market needs a return of confidence that the quality juniors are the ones that are doing stuff that can deliver discoveries, demonstrate that projects work at these things. Maybe it's a higher cutoff grade in the existing system. But with these levels here, it's a return of confidence in the resource sector that's key. And that's the inflection that has happened. The risk that, oh, this is another sucker's rally, it's back into the long downtrend, I think we've managed to push that out of the way.
Yeah, and you know, I agree, John, and I think that that's what the technical indicators are telling me. What your fundamentals are saying is that I think that's the next trend. We're going to chop our way towards 1300, maybe break out and, you know, the last quarter get somewhere between 13 to maybe even 1400 on the high end by the end of the year. But nothing where it gets, you know, I'm tired of that volatility in the market. I would rather just have a nice, you know, nice little bull market that takes a long time to develop, and the focus is on quality, because that's what, you know, John, at the end of the day, that's what you do in your reports, right? Is you're looking for quality, you're trying to filter out the noise and find the signal. And again, you know, I'm not going to wait until late into the show today. Now that the market is trending in the right direction, there's going to be a lot of new people watching these shows that I do. And I want to highly recommend you get on John Kaiser's website and also sign up for subscribe to his reports. He does a phenomenal job. And I think now was a perfect time to mention that, John, because I want to talk about your big list there that you mentioned on BNN the other day. You have a list that you've filtered out a lot of companies, and you feel it's going to be your best list ever. You said that it was up 90% since to date. Is that correct? Did I get that right on BNN?
Yeah. Yes, the 100 companies as a group are up 90% since the start of the year. And they actually managed to go down about 10% in the first 2 weeks of January. So from the true bottom, which was mid-January, they're up even better. The venture index, which is about 400 companies, of which 200 are resource sector, is up only about 15-20% so far. So it was like shooting fish in the barrel. All you had to do was filter for companies that did not have negative working capital, that weren't in that zombie category, and then look at who's the management, you know, is the project interesting, and come up with a sort of 100 across the spectrum. And I've got all kinds of ones in there. I've got little polymetallic explorationists like Wolfton. I had a gold toiling geologist ones like Sirius, which is one of my top performers. I had more advanced ones like Arizona Mining with its Hermosa Taylor project, for which they came out with a resource estimate, and the stock is now over $1. I mean, another top performer. And then there's a few cash rich companies in there, some prospect generators. The prospect generators, by the way, have not done as well as the other ones with focused projects. I don't know if you have time, but I'd like to talk about the Sirius resources.
Jane. I wanted to, before we get into that, while we were talking about the work that you do in your reports, you also mentioned something else that kind of is a bee in my bonnet, or actually it wasn't you who had mentioned it. It was the Andrew, the interviewer. And he likened investing in mining stocks as if it was like putting money on a roulette table, but that roulette table has 1,000 potential outcomes. And I think that that's very misleading. And I want to tell people why. And I think that emphasizes what John is saying. If you take all of these companies that are listed in the on the Toronto Stock Exchange venture, with over half of them being zombies, and then you put that into your filter of how they perform as a whole, yeah, you're going to have a real hard time finding the winners. But you can easily separate, filter out 40, 60% of them right off the bat. I want to talk about that in a bit too, John. The 40% that are remaining, take away the ones that are lifestyle companies and not really that too excited about returning money for their investors, or they have an enormous amount to stock out. And even if they have success, how much are they going to go out? Then you start bringing the number down, 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 down to a much more manageable level of real companies. And John's list of real companies, not only is it the ones that are the first to react when the market recovers, they're also the ones that when we look back 5 years from now, are also going to be the big success stories 5 years from now. Some of those companies will still be talking about 5 years from now. I think I had a little rant I had to do there, John. What do you think about my rant?
Yeah, I mean, focusing on the real companies, it's the way to go right now. A point I made on BNN is like, who cares about these zombie companies? Something has changed in the last 10 years. The Canadian companies entered a new age of professionalism, technical professionalism, in that they took projects beyond generating a drill target and poking holes at it, getting a discovery, and then getting bought out before there's even an initial resource estimate. Now they not only produce proper resource estimates, but they do economic studies. First the PEAs, then pre-feasibility studies, even feasibility studies. And like one of my favorites, Scandian International, they want to go all the way and actually raise $100 million and put this thing into production and then scale it bigger after that. This is now the new standard. This is what the market has come to expect from Canadian juniors. And when as this bull cycle gains momentum and more people come, they're going to be discriminating. All those lifestyle guys, they're going to, you know, roll back, do debt settlements, roll back the paper, do fresh financings, have all this cheap paper, but they're not going to have a story to tell anybody because the market will see through it. And something that I'm building, by the way, a crowd-based outcome visualization system, it's going to totally make those pretend companies naked, because people will see this is junk. There's nothing going on here. There's no graphics on the website. There's no evidence of an exploration program. We just shun them. You don't need to regulate them or anything. They will just stand there as wallflowers because they got nothing on, and it'll be just it'll change it completely. Perfect. That's why if I don't know if you can get it set up on your computer, but if you can go to my homepage and click the outcome visualization button on the left side, just under Nevada Resource Center, you'll get a new graphic that I've created, and I haven't even told my readers yet about it because I've been working very hard developing the software to make this stuff actually work. And you'll see an outcome visualization chart for Sirios's Chichu project.
I'm just getting it up there for us, John. And that brings up a perfect point. Just bear with me a second here, John. I'm gonna get your screen share up there, hopefully. Can you see it, John?
Or do you can't see it.
Screen?
It's black.
Yeah, I did something wrong here. Sorry about that.
Is it going to be the same where if I can see it, nobody can hear me?
Yeah, but at least they can see what the chart looks like. And then as you're telling me about it, if I could get this darn thing to work, here, let me stop sharing.
I saw it for a second.
Yeah. I'll retry it again, John. It's a good timing on you to pick that up, John, because One of the things that I do on a daily basis is I spend a fair amount of time on a website called CEO.ca. It's a great forum for people that are in the market, investors, people, company people, the whole works. You've been getting a really big audience over there, John, due to your recent calls on this show, and you were just going to bring one up, which is Sirios. We are now. I'm also on the bandwagon. I followed it because of you, John, and what got me to pull the trigger and buy some stock at 22 cents, and on that day, put out a report. And you kind of made me look pretty smart there, John, because it traded up to 50 cents after I put the report out, was the whole 52 at their Chichu project. And let's start talking about SOI. And while you're talking, I'm going to work out this screen share.
All right. It's an interesting comparison between, say, Wolfden and Sirius. At the start of the year, both are companies that were trading below 10 cents with project valuations of less than $10 million. Wolfden is still there. It has not moved significantly. But Sirius, as you point out, has been almost at 50 cents. And what's happened there is exploration drilling has delivered some interesting intersection. But what has really happened is that the audience has become attuned to what is the potential of this big giant geochemical anomaly at the Chichu project, which is 15 kilometers southeast of the Eleanor mine that's supposed to be in production at 7,000 tons per day, but they're not able to go that high because the resource estimate is not quite what it was predicted. The mining is delivering less of a gold zone than was expected. So Sirius got its break in February when Goldcorp gave them $1 million at 13 cents with no warrants, at 13 cents, and had the special deal of being able to go to 19.9% in any future financings. And with that money, the company started drilling and they delivered several good intersections. They've reported visible gold on some big step outs to the northwest, which if those deliver any interesting values, well, then we're off to the races right away. But right after PDAC, that's when they pulled that first hole that caught people's interest, the biotite schist. And this is a rock type that shows up in the Eleanor mine at about 400-500 meter depth. And that started getting interest from people like Andre Gaumond, and we remember you had him on your show, and he was talking about this play still as people were figuring it out. So a lot of smart people in Quebec who know what makes Eleanor tick have their eyeballs on the Chichu project. And then they came out with that whole 52, which was the best grade interval. It still doesn't connect to anything because they don't have enough holes in that area to connect the dots, but it showed the market that really good high grade is possible within the system. When you look back at the geochemical footprint, you said, you know, there is a lot of room to find many, many ounces, especially if you go deep, such as Eleanor. It starts off as a flattish deposit, but then it goes vertical and it goes down 1,400 meters and is still open and has about a 1,500 meter strike. So there's about 4 kilometers of strike at the contact margin between the intrusive body and the country rock at Chichu, and the deepest they've gone is about 250-300 meters. So they've barely begun. And what got them excited about hole 52 is they also started seeing the gray wacky, which is not like those country rock paranises, which are pretty dead. Once you get into that, the gold disappears. But the gray wacky is the host at Eleanor. So the company suddenly went quiet, and we couldn't really understand what. They did one of these unusual things that the stock exchange allows, where they did a price reservation on a financing at 20 cents, and the company couldn't admit that it had this private financing going, and yet this financing was sold. And the problem they had, Goldcorp had 7 days to decide whether to go to 19.9%. So the stock, meanwhile, is trading into the 30s, and everybody's freaking out because, oh, that the stock exchange is going to pull the plug because the stock is running away, and they really hate it when the you know, stock is up above what the financing's supposed to be done at.
Maybe I shouldn't have put that report on what I did.
So fortunately, it worked out that the exchange understood that, yeah, Goldcorp is going to take its 7 days allowed. And Goldcorp did come back and went to 19.9% on a fully diluted basis, which was a problem suddenly for the IR guys who were like telling people there's this finance. And he says, oh, there's only $1.2 million left out of this $5.5 million that we're going to raise because of Goldcorp's taking a big chunk of it and some others have spoken for parts of it. So that finally got done. The company got $5.5 million in the treasury. They're up to 121 million shares fully diluted with Goldcorp by exercising its warrants going to 19.9%. That financing risk is gone. The default risk that they don't have 500 grand to make the payment to Golden Valley in June is gone. And the stock now has a valuation on a fully diluted basis of $51 million, which for those of you who have managed to pull up that graphic on the outcome visualization page, that's showing this used to be just a $10 million. Now that blue channel that you see in there, that's my rational speculation model saying that if my fantasy of a 13 million ton deposit of 9 gram per ton gold, 3.5 million ounces, were to be...
John, I think what might help our audience out is that a lot of our audience also follows charts and they know what a Bollinger Band is. John's valuation model is kind of like a Bollinger Band of the high and low trend of where a rational place for that thing to be trading is. And he mentioned that if you go to his website, look for that valuation model he's talking about right now, and you can see where SOI fits at this stage in the game. Sorry, John, go on.
Yeah, so what I've done is like the problem the market has is, okay, so this stock's got 120 million fully diluted. It is at 40 cents, 50 million valuation. Well, what is this based on? What are people expecting? And so what I've done through my site is created the facility where I can come up with a, well, here's what I would, in this case, what I would like it to be. And if it does come into existence, it would probably be bought out by Goldcorp, mined at 2,000 tons per day, truck the ore to Eleanor so that Eleanor can go up to 7,000 tons per day and not deplete their existing resource prematurely, which is important for all the community stakeholders in this region. Then I've, you know, taken the costs of the Eleanor project and said, okay, that's what it's going to cost to mine this. And I've left out the huge CapEx. I've only given them $200 million CapEx to build a hoisting facility and an underground mining facility because Goldcorp already spent $2 billion building this huge, fantastic infrastructure up there. Now, whether the company is going to get 13 million tons of 9 gram, who knows? But the geochemical footprint is large enough. But what I really want to draw people's attention to is the S curve. And you've probably heard of the S curve with regard to the technology sector, where you get the early adoption, you get the valuation go up, then reality sets in and it goes down, eventually converges on a fair pricing. We have something similar in the resource sector. So where when you have a new discovery and there's great uncertainty about how big it will end up, like the uncertainty isn't about how small it will end up, it's how much bigger than we already see will it keep growing as the drills turn. And you can see the yellow channel there is what gets observed, and it's this perverse, irrational tendency of the market to somehow price the project during the discovery delineation infill drilling stage at a value where it ends up being worth when it finally goes into production. And of course, once you publish your first economic study, you know, you've pretty much found the limits of the deposit. You're worrying
about that's based on, and that's at different stages as you take up more risk. So what you're saying, if I think I got this right, is at this stage in the game, they are pricing that for that result already. If you walk those other projects back to this stage and this time.
That's right. They do at this. They quite irrationally price what it will eventually be worth after it's had all the de-risking done.
But I got to tell you about my next report, then, John, that I just put out 2 days ago. I said that I put out a second report on SOI after I had done the initial one at 22 cents. And I said that it looks to me like the market is pricing this for perfection and that it's a good time to be taking some profits. Even if they are deliver great results, it still makes sense to take some profits here. I think that there's more risk right now because the market seems to be pricing them as if all those remaining holes are all around hole 52. And the reality is that hole 52 sort of sits out there on its own right now, which is tremendously exciting. I want to see more drilling around it. But you're pricing as if all those other holes that are pending are going to be as good. And I think that you have to remember another thing that you mentioned, John, is that those were rushed assays for that hole 52. They didn't rush any of the other assay results. So it was looking to me like the market was getting it way ahead of itself. And that's why I put that report out a couple of days ago. And it looks like your rational speculation model is on my side.
Yeah, and right now it's maybe a little overpriced in terms of my particular outcome. And I don't expect any better intersections in the remaining hole. However, it's the geological context, information about that, which is going to be critical. And that's what's attracted Goldcorp. The barn burner discovery hole really isn't here yet. But when they go back in there with 10,000 meter drill program, which will use less than half of what they've raised, they're going to go in there with a very focused program on multiple fronts. And this is going to be a make or break 6 months. If in 6 months they haven't latched into a zone where they can start connecting the dots, this play is probably a bust. But if they start to connect, the point I'm willing to make is, do you think the market will, like at the moment, they look at my 13 million ton outcome of 9 gram and say, boy, what are you smoking, John? You're really in fantasy land. But if you start getting holes that support that, in this type of market where we've gone from a bearish sentiment to a bullish sentiment half full, they're going to say, this is going to be just like Eleanor. This is going to be 20 million tons of 9 gram, maybe even bigger. I mean, the footprint is bigger than Eleanor. And so that's where the imagination goes wild. Right now, that S-curve there, we haven't seen a serious S-curve behavior in the junior sector for a long time. But what I'm predicting is we're heading into a window where exploration-driven S-curve market behavior is going to become a reality, and that's going to shock a lot of people. Because right now, yes, you should be selling your Sirius at 40 cents, take your 300% profit off the table. But you shouldn't sell all of it.
Oh, absolutely. No, no, no.
Some
no.
of it, redeploy into the Wolftons that haven't yet even adjusted.
I said book some profits. I didn't say take all your profits and leave this play. And if you're not in the play, I think you also have to consider what John is saying about, well, if things get out of hand and people get really, really optimistic, you may not have another chance to get a ticket into the game. And so you may have to consider, even though maybe it's a little richly priced right now, do I still want a ticket? Because right now I don't have a ticket. And this could be the kind of project that catches the imagination of the market and helps turn this market into more bullish scenarios. So, you know, I was saying it in context of my readers that picked up on it and my viewers that picked up on it early since we've been talking about it and where we are now, sort of. I think that anybody who's new to the story, you really have to consider, well, even though it's a little bit overpriced, maybe I take a little bit of a position now, hope it comes down a little bit. If it doesn't, I buy my other half a position, maybe even a little bit higher. This is definitely a game I think you want to be in as far as having a ticket in something that could hit it out of the park.
Now, Alan, one thing that people should keep in mind is the capital that's been sort of pouring back into the sector is the capital of hardcore speculators in this sector. And that's going to be a finite amount. However, with the trend reversal that we've seen, with companies now such as Sirius geared up to deliver more results, what you have is that all this other potential pools of capital that are about to discover this sector. And so you look for plays like this where there's a good chance that you will get a much better hole that brings in new pools of capital. And so this is how this ecosystem works, because the people who bottom fished for this stuff in the beginning of the year and, you know, may have taken some profits, they're in there recycling it in the cheaper ones that haven't moved. And when new capital comes in and say takes serious to 60, 80 cents, because all of a sudden we're seeing zones come together, or perhaps those Northwest holes have better grades than are expected, well, then there's an even greater liquidity. So you get this cascading of profits from the sort of smart money, the bottom fisher types, the sophisticated investors, as they take the easy money off the table from having had the courage to buy when it looked absolutely horrible. They will go down the food chain. And the point I made earlier, it's good to have the little Wolfston idling at the dock, because their turn will come. This is the best part of the whole market cycle, is after a long downturn, you see a genuine turnaround, and it doesn't happen everywhere at once. It happens in certain, you know, focal centers. And as you start making money, you can go down and get other sides. It's when everything pops up in unison. So, okay, you made your 300, 400%, but the only thing you can recycle the money into is everything else that's up 300, 400%. So this type of gradual turnaround is it's heaven for people who are addicted to the resource juniors.
You know, John, to me, it feels almost like some sort of a renaissance, like exploration is an in thing again, and that, you know, we're where people want to be. So, and you know, and I also made recent arguments that Canada, the CAD, is Canadian dollar, is a better place to have your money than the U.S. dollar. It's commodity dependent. I think commodities are going to go up. John, you've been just great on this show. You've had some phenomenal picks, not just SOY. I got to thank you again for being so good to my audience and being able to give us the whole, right from the when you first talked about them, you laid out the exploration program, then they delivered, and I think they've got excellent things ahead of them when they get drilling more around that hole 52. And also understand more about the geology that they're going to learn from this program as well. Another company that you talked about is AZ, well before anybody started getting excited about that stock. Have you put that into your new model that you've been working on, John? And where does it sort of factor in? I know you haven't sort of launched this yet.
Well, no, I have. In fact, I've done outcome visualization for Hermosa Taylor. I mean, right now the resource is 40 million tons, and I've imagined it as, okay, they want to do 8 to 10,000 tons per day operation, which is about sort of the upside limit for underground mine of this sort. So what do they need for a 20-year mine life? Well, they need 60 million tons. So I said, okay, the footprint is so substantial relative to what the resource is already based on that they will easily get to 60 million tons. So I've run an outcome visualization, which people can go to the website and they can see the free portion simply by clicking on the outcome visualization project. The actual outcome visualization, which has all the detailed assumptions, you got to be a member of Kaiser Research Online to see what this is based on. But this thing, you know, once it's set up, it tracks the price of the metals, and it adjusts to it all the time. So when zinc surges towards 90, that will end up being reflected. And right now, with this scenario, I said if it became reality, the project would be worth $1.1 billion Canadian. And it's at the upper limit of the fair value range, which is $250 million. Now, this project won't quite get the S-curve because it's much more advanced than, say, a Sirius type of thing. But there's still a potential to double or triple in a frenzy if they have 1,000-meter step-outs and are starting to get, instead of 4.5% zinc, 4.5% lead, they start getting like 9% zinc and 9% lead, and people start thinking, whoa, maybe they're going to end up with 50 million tons of a combined 15% lead zinc, which is a lot more valuable than 9% lead zinc. So the framework's there for people to track the results, to build their expectations, and adjust their bets accordingly. When fresh news comes in, they
I must be a tech geek or something, because every time you bring up one of these new filters, it just it kind of sets me off, because you just made a couple really important points there. Don't be out looking for those S curves in more advanced projects, for one, or if you're hopeful of an S curve happening to one of those more advanced projects, they better be doing some exploration drilling or step out drilling, something that can bring that S curve kind of action into the play. Did I get that right?
Absolutely. You need to have drills turning to generate the results that change people's expectations about what this project is turning into. That's why fuel in the tank is so critical. That's why these zombie companies with negative fuel in the tank, they're just going nowhere. They can't participate. They are stuck on the sidelines. There's all these people running around complaining that the stock exchange needs to, you know, pound a stake into the heart of these zombies. No, they're harmless. They're not really biting. No, if there are stupid people enough to go and buy one of these zombie companies, they deserve to lose their money. They probably didn't deserve to have the money in the first place. The zombies are not a threat. They are just these things that you need to ignore. And the simplest way to ignore them is to look at their balance sheet. And if it's negative, see you later. Clean up your balance sheet. And I've told companies who have pitched me, and I said, no, your story's potentially interesting, but until you clean up your balance sheet, I am not going to even pay any attention to you, because there's 500 other companies out there with positive working capital balances, and those are the ones that are going to move first in this market. And there are some good groups that ended up underwater. I'm not going to mention them, because these are like 2-3 cent stocks of the extreme variety, which as I get liquidity in some of these other movers, I will be buying those, because I know these are good management teams. They will clean up the debts. They've got projects that are very interesting. Well, I will mention one of them.
Subscribers will get that list as well, right, John?
Oh, yeah.
Okay, perfect.
Yeah, except these things don't even qualify for a list. But an example, remember we talked about Canalaska and its diamond play in the Northwest Athabasca Basin? Fjordland Explorations has went and staked all these claims surrounding the little postage stamps that Peter Dazzler and Carl Schiemann staked to cover the obvious kimberlite targets. I mean, this company's got negative $200,000 working capital, but it's...
I was going to ask you, John, that is the kind of stock you want to look at if you're hopeful of finding one that could have that S-curve type action, is that CVV that you've been kind enough to shine light on it in this show. So go back onto your CVV there, John. I think you're giving us some good info.
I mean, the Canalaska, I ended up adding it to my bottom fish list to replace one that did a big rollback and disqualified itself. And right now, Cameco is drilling a high-stakes hole on the West MacArthur project in an area where they don't quite understand what's going on at depth, but the geological context suggests that there could be a uranium system. It's not that far from the Fox Lake deposit, which is 400,000 tons of 7 or 8% uranium. And we talked about this before, or on one of the other groups that I was talking with. I mentioned this is $1,000 rock. No, it's actually $3,000 rock, this deposit. So if Cameco discovers this system following the sea conductor extends onto Canalaska, Canalaska nets 40%, has 25 million shares fully diluted. So that means that at 40 cents where it's now, 10 million, it's like a $25 million valuation. You find something that looks like Fox Lake on their property, and that's going to be worth $500 million or more, similar to NextGen. So you're talking a stock going up not 5 times, 50 times in valuation. So that this type of a move, that would be the S-curve. If you lock into a high-grade interval there on this project, which the market's saying probably not there, you will get S-curve behavior on the
project. Well, and with CVV, which is one of the only prospect generators that has actually moved with this trend, they give you multiple swings at the bat for that S-curve type action, don't they, John?
Yeah, well, that's back to like Fiordland and the Diamonds story. The Diamond story is completely separate. In fact, it's some of the shareholders are grumpy because they see this as a distraction. They want the uranium exposure. Well, the company could at some point just split itself into two and issue one share for the Diamond division and one share for the uranium division and carry on that. But if this field of diamond kimberlites or targets turns out to be a kimberlite field with meaningful diamond content in it, then like that little hanger on Fiordland, whose CEO Dick Atkinson he's like a proven success story, except now he's in one of these lulls, and even the superstars end up in these lulls where they consigned him to an inner room that used to be a storage room. He has no windows. I mean, here's a guy who's had like multi-hundred million dollar buyouts, and now he's stuck in the inner office, and he's put all his paintings and that in there so it's not so ugly. Well, this little 2-3 cent stock, this is the kind of extreme bottom fishing that I will do privately, because I can't recommend it to people when it's 200 grand in the hole. But if I'm pretty confident that the Canalaska...
Why not put a potential zombies that might come out of death row type, the death row list?
Well, Alan, I got to make some money myself too, right? You know, I buy the 2-3 centers and I don't need any competition for those, and especially explain why are you recommending a company that's technically insolvent? So that becomes too hard to explain to a readership.
The death row list. John, you can throw me a couple of death row picks every once in a while after you load up. I like those death row
picks. Well, I'm working on one right now. It's actually in the niobium space, but I'm not going to tell anybody because the deal might not even close. So if I share this with somebody, I have a chance to have a lot of egg on my face. So I'd rather just own the thing at 3 cents or 3.5 cents and take the hit. If it all falls apart, then they do a 10-for-1 rollback, and that's these extreme high risk things. You need to really understand the game. It is not for ordinary retail investors. When they come in for those types of plays, they end up massacred. It's better for somebody to come in and buy a Canalaska or a Cirios, which has gone up 3-4 times, is cashed up and all that, and has something going that can deliver fundamentals that give it another 3-5 time upside move.
You know, John, you got me now. I'm thinking in S-curve kind of things now. If the Bollinger Band is sort of the way that things should evolve on sort of a normal thing with the discovery, this S-curve is where it gets really exciting. And I think that your list has a lot of S-curve potential in it. Have you considered just selling that list, John? I think that's considering it's the most important list, I think it's even valuable after it's up 90% to be watching it, because if we have a pullback or these are the companies you want to watch. And or if you come up with some extra cash from a winner, maybe plugging it into one of those is a good idea. Have you considered just selling the list on its own?
Well, Alan, that is my business model. For $100, you get 30 days access to everything, which includes the list. So it is for sale.
For $100. Yes. There you go.
US.
There you go.
Not quite as terrible as it was at the beginning of the year for Canadians.
That 100, yeah, exactly. Get a little easier on us. And I think it's going to get a little easier too. But don't delay. $100 is really worth it, especially just to get that list. And use his filtering tools. They are phenomenal. There is nowhere on that you can go. An investor today, if they're on John's site, can be better than any money manager out there if he wants to do his homework. And John gives you all the tools that you need to do your homework. I've been in this business since 1993 looking for these kind of tools. And every time John comes on, he comes up with another tool that just blows my mind. It's $100, folks. Get on there. John, we talked about subscribers. Lately, the Golden Triangle has been getting a little more attention. Are you following some companies up there?
Well, I'm scrambling to catch up. For example, Colorado, which used to be a Spec Value Hunter recommendation, but which I downgraded, a year and a half, two years ago, it was a below 10 cent bottom fish, and it's now 22, 25 cents. So again, what we were talking about earlier.
More than that, isn't it?
Maybe today. I mean, things are quicker than I can pay attention.
It's been moving real good lately. Go on about the, sorry, John, I just.
The North Rock project has a low grade copper resource, which we got all excited about several years ago, but it's just not high grade enough to be another Red Chris type system. But they have all this other gold exploration potential in the Golden Triangle. And the fact that they have gone up into the 20s from, you know, being stuck at 7 cents, that's a sign of the returning investor interest in exploration plays.
35 pennies, John, up.
Oh, you're kidding. I can't keep track of my own bottom fish. This really is the popcorn effect. All these kernels are popping so fast that I can't even track each one.
Yeah, I've had PVG in my top gold pick since the early part of the year. It's been doing real well, and I just added IDM to my list. IDM Mining, run by Rob McLeod. Are you watching that one, John?
No, I haven't watched that one. Is this the Red Mountain play?
This is the Red Mountain play. Okay. Right behind, it's one valley or over one hill from Stewart, and they're now funded up to do. They just raised $10 million. They're funded up to do their feasibility study, and what Rob's game plan is to push towards getting this into production. It looks like it could be a low cost ticket to get it into production and use that funding and the underground workings to do the real exciting exploration instead of trying all those holes from way up top. And so they've got the funding to do that and still have like only about a $20 million market value. I think they've got a lot of upside, and I might even try to get up there this summer, John, and do a property visit. Apparently, Rob says, Al, you just look around and you can see the exploration targets all over the place.
Yeah, good luck. I tried that last year. I went with Skeena to visit the Spectrum, you know, flew all the way up there, and just the fog never lifted enough for the helicopters to take us to the actual site and see the drills and the zones and all that kind of stuff. So
is there any chance if there is a visit up there to Red Mountain, you'd want to get on it, John?
Well, I might be interested. It all depends on timing and all that. You know, one of the things I have to do is now go through my filters again, because some companies, they're being taken over from the bottom fish list. And I like to keep it topped up at 100 companies. So I'm like got to go through there and find others that I may have overlooked or where something has happened in the meantime, which has made it stronger, and check and see if I can add those to the bottom fishing list.
Well, I'll make sure and send you an email if I hear of one happening and what the details are, John. So scoops for us today, John? Anything exciting on your mind that's just popped in there in the last few days?
There's one of my favorites, and I shouldn't mention the name, apparently is going to do a financing that is going to enable it to do an important geophysical survey on a MacArthur River scale target out there. And this is in the Athabasca Basin. Yeah. This company's been one of my, you know, top picks. It's been stuck in the mud. But the management has been reluctant to dilute, but I've heard that they may be willing to actually contemplate a financing. So if that happens, and again, this is a sign, this market wants to see activity. We don't care how good your project is or your concept. If you're not doing anything, we don't want to own your stock right now. InZinc, another one of mine, actually moved 5 to 10 cents up a couple of weeks ago, and of course that was in response to zinc, and I've been bugging management to You know, you got to get something going. You've got expiration potential. Forget about waiting for zinc to go to a $1.20 to make your project not worthless. You know, go and see if it's much bigger and better than you've always imagined. So
I think one of your subscribers might have, that also is on CEO.ca, might have guessed the company in the uranium space that you're talking about, because they asked me to ask John about Uravan, UVN.
Well, this is a company that has a great radiogenic lead isotope target on its Outer Ring project. They've got another target where Cameco should have been drilling, 4 to 6 deep holes this year, but because they didn't have to, they've deferred until next year. And these are the guys who have the key to finding the deeper high-grade uranium deposits where geophysics just generates too many spurious targets. These guys collect geochemical evidence at surface, and they've demonstrated at Cigar Lake, at Centennial, and CMIC and Cameco are doing a footprint study on MacArthur River. And the rumblings that I hear that this method that they've applied there is also kicking back. Yes, here's the signature, the geochemical signature. So these guys, if they get off their butt and actually get something going, they already have the geo.
Let me get this right in my mind. Are you saying that they've done this? They've done these surveys and they've done them over top of ones that are known in the area and have proved that this works?
Yes. Now, of course, hindsight's easy.
Right.
It was like the joke with BHP and a special Falcon system. It was able to detect every single known kimberlite in the Northwest Territories, but it did fail to find a single new kimberlite. So it's, you know, get a geochem target, drill it, and prove that you've got this. Then you're off to the races. I mean, it's the same like my other favorite, Nevada Exploration Inc., with its hydrogeochemistry strategy. They know it works, that the anomaly shows up on the Twin Creeks deposit. But, you know, show me an anomaly where there's no known deposit, drill it, and deliver something. And then if you deliver that type of proof of concept, then you're away to the races. And there's another one I've been sort of on their case saying, what are you guys doing? You know, you reorganized, you got new management on there. Why aren't you out there doing any drilling programs or anything? Get something going. The market doesn't want to hear about your great concept about finding Nevada's missing gold in Nevada by doing hydrogeochemistry. Take some of these targets, raise some money, poke some holes into it, and show some success. The misery of the last 5 years where you needed a barn burner hole to count a success, it's gone. Now if you have encouraging evidence, and we've seen that with the Sirius Chichu play.
Just a sniff, John. All they need is a sniff now. Go and prove a target and put a hole in it and get a sniff. I'll be all over the story. Everyone will be all over the story. I could understand in the past their little reluctance to want to be putting holes in the ground during a bad market. These management have to be able, the reason they're small the advantage of being small is you can turn on a dime. Well, turn on a dime, boys, because the market has turned. And now, instead of just sitting there as a sort of a science project, you can actually roll your sleeves up. And if you can prove that that works and just get a sniff, like I said, you're off to the races and you're going to get a lot more attention. I like where you're thinking with Nevada. John, before we wrap things up, I'm really buying into this scandium idea. It's one I'm thinking that I want to keep owning more of. They recently had some results out. I know the market hasn't really bought into this yet. It's one of those ones where I think it, sooner or later, sort of like my Wolfden, sooner or later the market's going to figure out what they have. And when they do, they're going to be paying more for it. And this scandium story, they've done their, let's talk about Scandium International. They did their, they had some news out recently, John. Let's talk about it before we close things off.
Well, they published the results of their definitive feasibility study. And that has an accuracy level of 15% versus the 30-35% of the PEA that they put out in October 2014. So the numbers are very similar. CapEx a little bit more expensive, and the IRR a little lower, but the NPV is still the same for a 36 to 42 ton per annum output operation. And the stock hasn't really moved, even though the project's valued at about $50 million right now, but the feasibility study says at a 10% discount rate, this is worth about 210-220 million Canadian. And it's been a bit discouraging to watch this because the market has not responded to these higher accuracy level. But I think it's just a matter of time. The market's still hung up on this idea. Is there an offtake market for scandium? And there was some joker who was trashing an article that came out in the Australian Times, which talked about Robert Friedland and his Syreston project. And this is the first time they seem to have let Robert out of his cage with regard to scandium. And they actually say Robert has a secret, and it's that the Syreston project has also got a definitive feasibility study underway, which they'll have in the next 6 months. At some point, they will have that out there. And it's a similar scale operation. And so some joker in England who used to peddle this stuff that he sourced from Russians or that had managed to filch it from the stockpiles and so on, and he's no longer able to do that because that just doesn't work anymore. He's there trashing this, warning everybody, stay away from scandium. There's no chance that anybody will be able to sell this stuff. And that just shows the limited thinking of so many people out there, even ones familiar with scandium, because scandium's about latent demand. There is so much latent demand potential.
That is what got my attention. I don't really care about the numbers. I don't care about these financing numbers, these economic numbers. What you are talking about is what excites me about scandium, is that if anybody can prove, and it looks like they can prove that they can provide the market, that there is more demand, there is more pent-up demand there than the market could handle in the next 10 years, let alone, and that's what excites me. One of the great books I read on the market was by Peter Lynch. And he talked about how he looked at pent-up demand in automobiles and made a lot of money over the years buying into automobile stocks when they were really cheap. I think that's what gets me excited about your scandium story, is that potential to prove the market and unleash that pent-up demand.
See, the thing with the automotive and aircraft industry, which really needs aluminum scandium alloy to improve their fuel efficiency, is this is serious business, incorporating a new material into your business plan. And until you see a company producing from a primary deposit this stuff at the kind of cost that they predict, meaning that they'll be able to stay in business and sell this input, this material at a fixed price indefinitely and scale up, you would have to be out of your mind to start tooling up for making aluminum scandium components. So the aircraft industry and the automotive industry are these giant gorillas in the wings, which in 3-4 years, when the, say, Cleantech and Scandium International have demonstrated that their stuff works, they are all in. The demand in the meantime will come from mundane applications. For example, phone cases, an aluminum scandium case for your smartphone, or something like beer cans, you know, hydroformed beer cans in interesting shapes and so on. They cost more, and they also weigh more, because and that's a problem for the beer guys, because shipping the container for the beverage is a cost of a
but they cost sure of business. Want that product, because that unlocks a lot of profit. And you know, you said something there that also strikes me, John. You said that there are these gorillas out there. The crazy thing that I don't think the market understands is that those gorillas are out there, and those gorillas have to have scandium.
But this is the beauty of like the beer market. They don't have to have it, or the smartphone market. It is discretionary for them. They can plan to do this. And if it doesn't become available because the chemical plant doesn't work properly, So what? They don't do this limited edition of the Galaxy 7 or the iPhone 6S or whatever. Same thing with the beer can. You want to do a fancy version of a Pabst or Schlitz beer, which is really a sort of a blue collar beer, which does not have any fancy can.
Or Kaiser Bottom Fish Report beer.
Yeah. So something sort of like a low level type of thing where you really wouldn't want to waste money on it unless it made a lot of sense. Well, they could say we'll do this. And can you imagine like a Pabst beer or a Schlitz beer? They have their big hipster following. The hipsters would never want to drink out of a fancy Pabst or Schlitz beer. But what about all those blue collar guys with their favorite beer? All of a sudden, there's one with a cool shape. And it's still cheap because they've used aluminum scandium and they have the rigidity with a lower weight can than all the other fancy cans from the other bigger firms. So
how many applications are there like that, John, where it makes, where there's a market out there. It's a point of having the product to move into the market with.
There's all kinds of applications, even something like high tension wires. You don't need to do any special certification for that. But if you want to reduce the distance between transmission towers, you use aluminum scandium alloy. And they can't do it right now because there's not enough scandium to make that possible. China's got stranded wind farms.
Now, John, hold on. Would they is it almost like they have to if it was available?
If it was available, they
on
would,
an economic sense. Sorry, that's what I was trying to get.
Yeah, no, yeah, no. They would use it because you get this functionality that you would otherwise have to pay for over and over again using other applications. For example, high tension wires use copper as a core for aluminum wires to give it the strength so that they don't have to build the tower so close because aluminum, while a fantastic conductor, suffers from thermal sag, where when it gets heated, it stretches. So you can't have those transmission wires drooping down onto something and frying the system.
Boy, good to my head.
and this is something people don't understand about aluminum scanning. You think, okay, well, your hunk of aluminum with scanning is going to cost more than say any competing alloy or whatever, because lithium or magnesium or whatever is really really cheap, but when you get taken into consideration fabrication costs, maintenance costs, all these indirect
costs,
and you add those in, and then suddenly you can subtract them because your aluminum scandium alloy material is so much more workable, is also corrosion resistant. So like with phone cases, they have this Series 7 case for the 6S, which is of aluminum magnesium zinc alloy, but they still have to have a little special coating on it so it doesn't corrode. With aluminum scandium, yeah, it may cost more physically for that.
But it'll be raw metal.
You don't have to waste money putting a coating on it.
It'll be raw metal. That feels
right.
Cool.
And it'll feel a lot better.
That feels cool. I love that feeling.
So these types of savings, they're all over the place with aluminum scandium alloy. And I think, if these things go into production, the scandium, at least these initial scales of 40 tons per year by Cleantech and Scandium International, this will get mopped up very, very quickly. Okay. The bigger stuff comes later.
John, if we're looking at potential plays out there, what are the serious ones, and why is Scandium International your pick? You've talked about them tons on various different shows. I know you well enough to know, John, that you do your homework and you're not putting yourself out on the limb on a half-baked idea. Why is that your pick, and what are the other players out there, if there are any?
Well, Scandium International was the only one that I was aware of that had this type of deposit with, 300 ppm or better when I started covering it 4 or 5 years ago. In 2014, or late 2014, I learned that there was another deposit, which was the Syreston nickel cobalt deposit that Robert Friedland had. In fact, when I was trying to rescue Scandy.
Is that in a private vehicle or is that a public vehicle?
CleanTech is public. But okay. But at you know, in mid-2014, when the company needed to raise money to maintain its stake in this project, I tried to interest them. Robert Friedland's group in this guy said, this is a perfect story for Robert. It's you know, it's got all this futurism attached to it. It's got this environmental dimension to it. This is perfect for him. He should take over this deal. What I didn't know was that the nickel cobalt Syreston deposit, also in New South Wales, they had realized that what we originally treated as the marker zone, where the good nickel cobalt grade starts to fall off because the scandium went up, that it was the scandium, the donut around the hole, that was the valuable commodity. And the problem was it was stuck inside Ivanhoe Mines, which has these fantastic copper and zinc projects in the DRC and a good platinum project in South Africa. So it was buried in there. And so Robert was involved with the CleanTech, which is an ASX-listed company with some ion absorption technology for cleaning waste streams. And he said, you know, we can use this for stripping the scandium out of solution once we crack it with HPAL. So they moved the Syreston project out of Ivanhoe Mines into CleanTech on quite cheap terms, and they've been working on figuring out how to make this tick since the start of last year. And they've probably shrunk the lead that Scandium International has on them by only three six months. It's a somewhat it's a bigger project, somewhat better grade, and both these projects need to come on stream. There's a couple more deposits of similar grade, but they are owned by dysfunctional companies whose management doesn't get it. And worse, Robert Friedland's CleanTech has tied up all the water rights in that particular area where those deposits are located. This is a very water-starved area. And Robert, who's no slouch in thinking these things all through, has tied up the water rights. So those projects are going nowhere.
And International have to worry about water issues?
Yeah, no, they are 150 kilometers away from this. They're in an area that the water is not drawn from aquifers, which have to recharge. This is an area which gets its water from precipitation and rivers, and there's all kinds of water rights owners and the farmers and that, which can be sold. So in that area, the water rights are not a problem.
Perfect, John. Well, I think we did a good job again talking about any things. Did we miss anything you wanted to talk about? I caught your show yesterday on BNN. You did a great job again there, John. Did we miss anything?
I'm sure we did, but I think we've gone over an hour. We don't want to try the patience of our audience any further.
Exactly, John, exactly. And thanks again for that update on SOI and your AZ and your CVV, SCY, and that list. I really want to keep pushing people towards that $100 offer John has so that they can get that list from the PDAC, because I think you're going to want that list for long time into the future. I saw the same thing happen with, we talked about this last time, John. I picked 50 some companies before the last sort of big move up in gold. And there's companies on that list that are still growing. And, you know, Lakeshore Gold was a 25 cent stock back when I picked it in the last cycle. You know, KGI was a 20, 30 cent there. Now it's what, 10 bucks, $9? Those lists that kind of get forgotten about, this one John put together, you're not going to want to forget about that for several years into the future.
Yeah, well, like take example, Adventure Gold was one of my 10, 12 centers on there. Probe Metals was there as a 35, 40 center, trading below its cash breakup value. Since then, Probe, which had 19 million bucks in the treasury, has agreed to acquire Adventure Gold and its portfolio of gold prospects. So they're marrying Probe's management team and their big treasury and all their creative geological thinking to Adventure Gold. So Probe's now up at over 80 cents. Adventure has climbed to over 30 cents. It'll disappear. And this company, you know, an 80 center, it will have multiple exploration programs going, run by people who love exploration, who aren't just into drilling off existing resources and, you know, infill drilling them and demonstrating that we need $2,000 gold for this to be.
Well, you know, that's John, why I really think it's so important for people to get that list, is because it filters out all the junk and it does get you the list of people that are serious in this business. And those are the guys you want in this next cycle. Those are the guys you want to stick with, because like John says, we've got way better at filtering out the junk. Everybody knows what those zombies are. And like he says, they're dying a slow death, but nobody cares. Nobody's paying attention to them. Even though the TSX blabbed about what they were going to do, nobody cares about them. And I guess that's the ideal thing anyways, John. We investors should be the ones that govern this market, because the bureaucrats, they don't really care about the market. They care about their retirement packages. And I said to somebody after my coach came out here, I said, who cares if he was nice enough to come out here and take the punishment? He gets a big wage. He has to work for it once in a while, and it won't be long before he retires. And he just retired, or he's retiring in a few months. So like you said, we're doing real good at filtering out. And if you want one of the best filters in the business, Kaiser Research Online, you got to sign up for that. John, thanks again for coming on. You've done a great job, and we're going to keep getting you on a regular basis, because you always bring the crowd now that you're on fire.
Thanks, Alan. It's been good to do this session again. Look forward to the next one.
Thanks a lot, John. On that, before I close, I always like to stress that this show is for information purposes only. It's important for you to do your homework and speak with your financial advisors before making any investment decisions. I want to thank my sponsors, the viewers, and my guest, John Kaiser, for coming. You all make this show possible. Thank you very much, and have a great day.
And Alan, just a